Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman. This is another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Klaas, and he's going to talk to me about Azure File Sync.
You betcha.
And some of the new hybrid storage features.
You bet. So Azure File Sync is a new capability we're bringing out for Azure Files, mm-hmm. and it allows people to replicate their on-prem data that they store in file servers or Windows Server 2012 or 2016, mm-hmm. 2012 R2, up into Azure, and do it that in a way where you get multi-site sync. You can access the data on multiple file servers or up in Azure. You can also tier the coolest data where the file server turns into a cache, an on-prem cache. Mm. So all the files are up in Azure Files, and only the files that you need are on the file server, even though it looks like they're all there. So even if the physical drive space is limited, mm-hmm. the logical drive space is unlimited, if you will.
You're extending the drive into the cloud and effectively giving yourself unlimited
Exactly,
space.
Exactly. And then the third benefit is integrated backup and rapid restore. Mm-hmm. So we can integrate with Azure Backup, we can do file version-based restores, and then we can also do a rapid server DR and restore, or rapid restore, I should say, mm-hmm. where if somebody loses a server, you just add a new server, VM, physical, doesn't matter, and we rapidly bring down the namespace, and then based upon demand, we bring the additional contents down.
Interesting. Yeah. Now, I've got a legacy application, also known as my blog, that runs actually in a virtual machine on Windows Server 2012, mm-hmm. and I'm kind of afraid of it.
Right.
I want to move it to the cloud, but I live in fear of this application because right. it works fine. Mm-hmm. But I know I need to get it up into the cloud. And it has a unique aspect because it has hundreds of megabytes, I think probably many gigabytes of log files, and its entire back end is actually not a database, but a bunch of XML files.
Yep.
So it's a
yep.
file store.
Yep.
This sounds like something I could possibly use.
It would be perfect. A lot of the customers we talk to say that they want to lift and shift their application from an on-prem scenario mm-hmm. to Azure.
Right.
But they're risk averse.
Very
right?
much.
They want to break things. And the fact that we do bi-directional sync means that they could move just a portion of it up into the cloud mm. while still running everything as well as an insurance policy on-prem. Because we're not setting up something new on-prem. We're using your existing file server as is. You download an agent, mm-hmm. you configure it, and then we add that cloud value to your existing file server.
Interesting. Okay, so I put the agent on my existing virtual machine, my existing 2012 workloads, and it automatically moves itself into the cloud.
Exactly.
What about conflicts and file conflicts? I think about syncing, I think mm-hmm. about file conflicts.
So we do a conflict resolution, which is very similar to other cloud-based, like user-type scenarios, where there will be a winner and a loser. The loser is the last writer. Mm-hmm. The loser will get appended with the name of the source server. Mm. So if you have two applications access the same file almost at the same time,
right.
you'll end up with file one and file one dash server two, mm-hmm. for instance.
Now you make an interesting point there where you say similar to consumer type things. This mm-hmm. isn't OneDrive or OneDrive for Business, which are like end user, business user type things where humans are thinking about files on a regular basis, is
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
This is a business.
This is more for customers that are currently using file servers because they need the performance or the API semantics of applications that require to set ACLs, long file path name, extended file characters in the name, those sorts of things.
There's a fellow who I work with who does real estate, and they have a file server with a VPN in, and they go //server,
right.
and they're forever running out of space because they're always selling houses,
right.
and they have PDFs and just thousands and thousands of files. When you said the coolest, that's not the most awesome. It's the least
recently used.
Least recently used.
So since we're a sync engine, mm-hmm. we can also set the policy where we basically on the on-prem file server only retain the most recently used files.
Okay.
All of the files are up in Azure, and then when a user application tries to access one of those files, we just transparently recall it.
Mm. See, that would be great for someone who's got terabytes and terabytes of data. They could have most of it up in Azure and maybe the last year of the real estate
exactly,
stuff.
Exactly.
Available.
And on this market, it's probably growing really rapidly for them. So.
I'm sure it will.
Yeah.
So let's see the demo.
You bet. So in the demo, the first thing you would do is you'd go to the marketplace and you do a search for Azure File Sync. And then you find Azure File Sync Preview. And so this gives some information about the service, and it also lets you to create, in which case I would add a name of that object, mm-hmm. and then the subscription. I'm going to go to an existing storage sync service I've already set up. Mm-hmm. And the reason I'm going to do that is because the registration of the server does take about 2 to 4 minutes.
Okay.
And so on this storage sync service, I've already created two servers. And it says they're both online. It gives you some information about them. And after registering the server, the next thing I would do to create a sync group, which is what we call a unit of replication, mm-hmm. the file set that moves around, is I would give it a name, select a storage account for my Azure File Share, and then pick one. So I've already created an Azure File Share mm-hmm. to use my sync topology, and hit OK. At this point in time, it's going to go ahead and provision that new sync group. And as the cloud endpoint gets provisioned,
yep, there it just showed up.
It just showed up.
Yeah.
I will go ahead and add the server endpoint. And I'll go ahead and use one of those two registered servers. And I just happen to know that they both have a volume called S
okay.
and a directory called branch data.
Okay.
So I'm just going to go ahead and type that in, and I'll take a look at the servers. Branch data. And I'll explain cloud tiering is that cool data feature. Mm-hmm. I'll explain that in one sec. And while that's coming up, I'll take a look at Ignite Server 1.
Okay, so you're now remoted into those Windows servers.
Exactly. And I said S branch data, which is a directory that has finance, sales, user data. Mm-hmm. Finance has some files in it. And then here, looks like it's still provisioning.
Okay.
I'll take a look at server number 2 while I'm waiting. And this also has the branch directory, branch data directory, but it's empty.
Right. I think it's so funny, as someone who's been in the business for many, many years now, that you apologize because it would take 2 minutes.
Too long.
To myself, in the past, projects like this to enable something as sophisticated as this would take weeks and weeks.
I know.
And here we are in the cloud going, this is going to take minutes.
Anything over 60 seconds. It's just not cloud time.
Absolutely unacceptable.
So I'll provision the second one. And as I'm doing that, I'm going to go ahead and take a look at the Azure File Share called 1. Mm-hmm. While I'm waiting for that.
Okay, and see what's in there.
Exactly.
And the quota there, did it just say 5 terabytes?
There's currently with Azure Files, mm-hmm. there is a quota limit of 5 terabytes. We are in the process of raising that. So that's one of the published roadmap items that we're going to increase the size. Mm-hmm. You can also set a quota on Azure Files. So if you want to, you can constrain it. But you're only charged for what you use.
That was my next question. Is this something that you're paying for Azure File Sync, or you're just paid for the underlying storage and File Sync is just...
A little bit of both.
Yeah?
So you pay for the underlying storage right. and the transactions, and then we also charge, in our public preview, $2.50 for every additional server past 1. So the first server is free, right? So people can test it out.
Sure, sure.
You know, pretty easy. And then every additional server is $2.50 in our public preview.
A month?
Yes.
That's not bad.
No. See, some people told us we should raise the price because it seemed kind of hokey, but what we really wanted to do is say, let's sell it pretty much at cost, and for us, the management interface and everything else, that seemed like a reasonable amount. It's because at GA, it'll probably double to $5 per server per month.
But still, it seems like a small thing to pay, because one of the things that you were mentioning before was that even restores aren't even a formal restore. It's just kind of an automatic thing. You can get your data back instantly.
Correct. And so, let's see.
Here's your file share, and that's where all the files are.
Right, and both
servers. Endpoints have lined up.
They both lined up. Oh. And so now, I didn't have to refresh, but it looks like it's already starting to file in.
Look at that.
And then on this, I'll notice the fact that all the files have come down, mm-hmm. But it did a rapid restore. We were talking too long. One of the things I like to show is that.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. is when you first look at it, it has the offline attribute, the OA attribute. Which shows that the files aren't really there, it's just the namespace that's
and
there.
And is that a Windows Server thing that's built in that knows that this is an attribute? Or
that's a standard Windows file system thing, and it's called a reparse point, which says the file is here, but it really is pointing somewhere else.
I know what reparse points are. Interesting.
And then we have a filter driver, which intercepts that and actually handles the transparent recall.
That is a very, very clean way to implement this. That's really
cool. It is. So that's kind of the simple scenario. So it just shows I am syncing between these two file servers now and Azure Files. I'll look at a more complicated scenario, and I set this up in advance because it does take, again, 2 to 5 minutes to quiesce, and I just didn't want to wait for that to happen. Mm-hmm. So this is sync group number 2.
Okay.
And just looking at what I set up, on the file server, you can have multiple sync groups. So at different places, like different drives, you can have it sync to different sets of servers. And there's really, I think in our public preview, we're limiting it to 25 or so. There's no real conceptual limit to what that looks like.
I really like that this takes existing workflows. I mean, not every business is ready or in a place where they can go and put OneDrive for Business out everywhere.
Right.
They've got a good workflow that works now. They've got hundreds, thousands, whatever number of users that are using SMB, they're using servers.
Correct.
And they just need infinite space and automatic built-in backups. I mean,
exactly.
You could do this in a weekend.
Exactly. Well, that's our goal. And so if I look at this one, it says that I have enabled cloud tiering with a 95% free space target, which means the system will try to retain 95% free on that volume, mm-hmm. which isn't very real world, but it's great for
example. It seems like 20% or 10% might be more reasonable.
Yeah, 95 seems a little extreme, and this one said a little bit more realistic, 10%.
All right.
And the file shares are going, or the sync locations are /log files. Mm-hmm. So when I look at the two servers, again, I'm RDPing into them, okay. and I look at log files.
Oh, there's the offline attribute.
Yep. And notice that they're different because the 95% target is the one on the left. Mm-hmm. And so all those files are considered offline at present. So if I look at, say, file number 8 here. Boot that up.
Size on disk, 0.
Size on disk.
3 megs.
3 megs. So it's showing that even though it's not taking up any space, it is logical size is 2.7 megs. And we also support partial file reads and writes. So as I touch some of these files, if I do that by just reading a block or writing to a block, it won't recall the whole file. It'll just recall the portion that it needs. And even though it's sitting here in an offline state, let me make this bigger.
And Notepad, of course, a non-cloud aware thing.
This was just a test file I used to create these files, but it transparently recalled when I double-clicked on it.
Now, if you have a filter driver that's going to go off and do all of this work, and that's the magic of this pluggable architecture, but latency is not zero. Mm-hmm. You're going to go up to Azure.
Correct.
Would Notepad or whatever the application accessing that file think this is a slow disk if there was a hiccup or a moment there where you had to do retries or download?
That's exactly right. It's invisible to the application what's going on underneath the covers. So they would notice it as a slower disk or a slower read-write operation, mm-hmm. but they wouldn't see anything different about it. Mm. So the applications don't need to be rewritten or changed in any way. It's very transparent to them what's happening. And it's up to the admin to specify the policy for what to keep on the local cache.
That was a 3-meg file, but it opened like that.
It did, and
there wasn't a hiccup, there wasn't a moment there.
No, and that was a smaller file, and it also depends on where the file servers are in relation to the Azure file share. Mm. So for this setup, I actually set up VMs in Azure. Mm-hmm. If you have a file server, for instance, that's over a slow link, you'd probably want to increase the amount of local cache.
That makes sense.
Right, you'd want to keep more of it locally because of that. If you had a good connection, you might increase the amount that you're caching because you can get away with that.
This is genius.
Thank you.
People need to know about this.
I think so.
Fantastic.
I totally agree.
All right. Wow. I am just absorbing how cool that was. I am learning all about Azure File Sync and hybrid storage here on Azure Friday.